Hi, my name is Matt Ozalis, and I'm an engineer at Keysight. In this video, I'll go over how to design a Class J power amplifier, and I'll also discuss the concept of continuous modes of operation for RF power amplifiers. These modes are useful because they allow the amplifier to maintain high baseline efficiency while giving the designer more flexibility in the choice of output load values. Now, let me start out by saying that Class J is a fairly advanced mode of operation, so to really understand how this works, you should already know the concepts that I covered in my previous power amplifier videos, which you can find at the link shown here. The objectives of my presentation are first to briefly review a few concepts that you'll need to know to understand Class J, and then I'll create a set of Class J waveforms, analyze exactly how they work, and also show how continuous modes can be realized mathematically from this baseline. And from there, we'll design a Class J amplifier using a gallium nitride device from Qorvo and a transistor model which was provided by Monolithics. I'll go through the design process to see how well I can match my theoretical predictions with a real PA topology, and as part of this design process today, I'll be using an ADS workspace that I built, which allows me to generate Class J waveforms based only on a set of DCIV curves from a device. It's a real time saver if you're doing this type of design, and you can download it for free at the link shown below this video. I want to start by briefly reviewing the basic classes of power amplifier operation. To set a device up to operate in a certain class of operation, we need to bias the transistor at both the input and output. For a power amplifier to operate efficiently, we present a resistive load to the device, which generally minimizes waveform overlap, and therefore dissipated power. If you only operate in this so-called linear region, you won't get very high efficiency, so to improve efficiency, we can reduce the bias so that the transistor only conducts current for part of the RF cycle. This is called class AB or class B, and it's also worth noting that this implies that the harmonics are all short circuits to allow for this nonlinear current waveform. The challenge of this type of operation is it really only represents a single point in frequency. We can also operate the transistor like a switch across a capacitor. This is called class E, and the waveforms for this can be extremely efficient, although the signal swings can also be very high. If we analyze, for example, the voltage waveform for a class E power amplifier, it's easy to see that the high voltage swing comes from the Fourier combination of a fundamental signal and also a properly phased second harmonic signal which boosts the amplitude. So to realize this type of circuit, we just present a combination of an inductive fundamental impedance and a capacitive harmonic impedance. This combination provides a waveform whereby the second harmonic boosts the fundamental in just the right way. So now let's talk about Class J mode. To build a Class J amplifier, I'll start out with a baseline of one of the basic modes of operation, like Class B, and then I'll apply the harmonic boosting trick from Class C operation. So here I'm showing the voltage and current waveforms for a Class B amplifier. The voltage in red is a sine wave, and the current in blue is a half-rectified sine wave. As I mentioned earlier, we present a resistive load to the fundamental frequency and short circuits to all of the harmonic frequencies. Now to go from Class B to Class J, instead of presenting a resistive load to the fundamental, I'll instead present a reactive load, like in a Class E amplifier. This inductive load phase shifts the voltage to the left, and the phase shift alone will actually degrade performance, but if we also present a capacitive termination to the second harmonic, the resulting waveform will get an amplitude boost just like the Class E waveform. The dissipated power, which is shown in pink, is shifted, but somehow the overall efficiency and also the power out of the amplifier are exactly the same as the Class B baseline case. This is a very meaningful observation. It implies that other modes can exist which have exactly the same performance as a classical mode of operation, even if the waveforms look different. To understand how to achieve these modes of operation, we'll have to do a little bit of basic math. I'll start with the voltage waveform for Class B. This is just a sine wave with a DC offset and a peak voltage which happens to exactly equal the DC offset at the point just before the amplifier compresses. So the signal swings from a maximum of twice the DC value to a minimum of zero, and because of that, it's possible to rewrite the equation for the voltage waveform like I'm showing here. It's just the DC value multiplied by 1 plus the sine of phase. To realize Class J, I'll just multiply this waveform by a similar function, 1 plus the cosine of phase. And that's it. This is the equation for a Class J voltage waveform. If you're not sure exactly how this equation results in a phase-shifted voltage signal with a harmonic boost, I can do a little bit more math to show you exactly how this happens. So let's expand this product out, and then it's easy to see that the addition of the sine and cosine functions gives a phase shifted Fourier component at the fundamental frequency. What about the product of the sine and cosine functions? Well, I can expand that using a standard trig identity, which results in a second harmonic voltage that adds in phase to boost the fundamental. And it turns out that you can also add a factor to the front of the cosine function. I'll call this alpha, and then sweep alpha from minus 1 to 1, and the result is a family of voltage waveforms. Class J is the case where alpha is equal to 1, class B happens to be the case where alpha equals 0, and there's also the mirror image of class J where alpha equals minus 1. This is called inverse class J. And in fact, there are an infinite number of possible waveforms in this range, and the really great thing is that every one of these voltage waveforms, when combined with the same half-rectified current waveform, results in exactly the same power and efficiency as the baseline Class B amplifier that we started with. Now, if you've watched my other videos on PA design, you know that I tried to build and share workspaces that are practical, useful, and will hopefully save you a lot of time. I use all these workspaces myself, and they're available to download for free at the link in this video. These are ADS workspaces, and you can also get a free trial of ADS at the link. In the Class A, A, B, and B video, I shared a workspace which draws a load line for a power amplifier. So all you need to do is generate the DC IV curves, and then put a marker on the knee voltage and another marker on the quiescent bias point. And from just those two points, the tool calculates output power, efficiency, and even draws the voltage and current waveforms for this condition. Now I've expanded this load line utility to generate Class J waveforms as well, and this workspace is available for free at the link below the video. Let me show you how the tool works. So here I have a set of DC IV curves, and let's say that I want to design a Class J amplifier for this device. So I'll start with a Class B load line, which I can make by setting the quiescent point to 0, and then there's a slide bar which allows me to adjust the value of alpha, and the tool updates the waveforms and provides the impedances that I'll need to present to the device to achieve these time domain waveforms. The red dot is the fundamental, and the blue dot is the second harmonic impedance. Also, the tool shows me the entire family of waveforms and impedances that result when I sweep alpha from minus 1 to 1. And notice how for each point where alpha is non-zero, the load line appears to balloon out. This is due to the phase shift of the voltage signal. Now let me show you how to design a power amplifier with this information. I'm going to work with a device from Qorvo. This is the TGF2952. It's a discrete power gallium nitride hemp on silicon carbide. And the model was provided by Monolithics, and I really like to use their device models. As a lot of my colleagues will tell you, I'm usually skeptical about designing a PA with a model that I don't know much about. And with Monolithics, I can just click on the help button in ADS, and it shows me a comparison of simulated versus measured data over a variety of conditions. So that gives me some confidence that this device will perform as advertised. The design methodology that I'm going to show starts with the impedances from the load line tool, and then I need to present these impedances to the internal current generator of the transistor. And this requires me to either know the device parasitics or to have access to the intrinsic nodes. So in the model that I'm using, I can access the voltage and current inside of the device, so this is very important for power amplifier design. To get a quick first pass cut at this design, the trick that I use is to work with this equation-based impedance block, and that allows me to just type in the impedances directly, so I can do this separately for the real and imaginary parts of the fundamental impedance, and I can also do it for each of the harmonics. Basically, after that, I just bias up the device and I put the impedance block at the output and sweep the impedance at the fundamental frequency, and I'll pick the one that hits my target impedance inside of the device, and I do the same thing for each of the harmonics. Then the next step is to build the PA, so I present this load to the output, and then I conjugate match the input and sweep the power, and I look at the impedances that I actually get inside of the device. So not surprisingly, they're shifted a little because the parasitics are nonlinear. They vary with input power. So I need to fine-tune the external load to match the impedances, and once I have these, then it's just a matter of finding the input power where my load line actually hits the knee voltage, and hopefully at that point I'll get the waveforms that I expected. And after that, the main goal is to physically realize this set of external impedances. So I like to start out with a good circuit topology and then use the optimizer in ADS to match the target external impedances as closely as I can when I'm using a real circuit. And that's just step one, though. It's, of course, a multi-step process where you add more and more realistic complexity. This is kind of classic RF design. But for today, my goal is to just get you to that first good step. So how did this go with the Qorvo device? Well, here's the load line that I drew. It's actually deep class AB. And then I selected alpha to be 1 so that I could achieve class J operation. I presented the impedance block to the device externally, and I swept this load with just a low input power. And you can see that an external impedance of around 25 plus J70 ohms hits the target impedance internally at the fundamental frequency. And from there, I just put this load on the output and designed an input matching network. This is just a conjugate match, and in this case, I added a stabilization network too. This is a parallel RC, and this stabilizes the device across frequency. And once I did some fine-tuning with the impedances, I ran the optimizer to realize these external impedances using a more realistic transmission line network, along with some bond wires, and I put this all together to make what I would consider a very good first cut at a PA. Now this is by no means the finished product, but it's a very good starting point. So let's see how well these results compare with the original prediction I made using the Class J load line utility. So here are the predicted and simulated voltage and current waveforms, and you can see that they agree pretty well, and so does the load line. There are some slight differences, mainly due to nonlinear parasitics, but considering that it took me about 20 seconds to make this initial prediction, I think it's quite good. One thing I want to also mention is that since these types of amplifiers use the parasitics as part of the design instead of just shorting them out, in some cases this means that RF current will flow through the parasitics instead of flowing into the load, and some power will be lost in the process. So for example, current from the internal generator will flow through the gate drain capacitance to the input instead of to the output load as intended. And this means that you may see some difference in power between the intrinsic and extrinsic nodes of the device. So in this case, I lost about half a dB between the internal and external nodes. And this is something that's expected and you need to consider as well as part of your design. I think this shows another reason why doing the design at the intrinsic node is really valuable, because it then allows you to understand what's causing these kinds of losses. In other words, if a certain parasitic is impacting your performance for a complex mode of operation, you can look for a device which has a low value of that parasitic. The design process that I'm describing gives insight into the issue rather than just guessing. And that's a Class J power amplifier. You can download the workspace which contains all of the designs and tools that I showed today by going to this link. It will definitely give you a huge head start with your Class J design. The tools that I showed you today work with any device, and in the workspace I'm also including a free open parasitic GaN model which we developed here at Keysight. In this model you can see all of the parasitics inside of the device and you can access the internal nodes, which really helps to learn about this design approach that I talked about today. I also did a Class J design with this device as well, and that's in the workspace too. If you want to use the model for the Qorvo device, you can download that at the Monolithics website, and I've made it so that once you get this model, you can also just drop it into the workspace and it will simulate. And if you want to get even more advanced, I'm including a tool that will allow you to generate a Class J design from a Class F baseline by open circuiting the odd harmonics. This is called Class FJ mode. So I put a lot of extra stuff into the workspace. Definitely check it out. Good luck and thanks for watching.